All That Stuff on BCTV is supported by the Renaissance Auction Group.
Hello, friends, and welcome to the June 2021 episode of All That Stuff. If you were watching last month, or maybe if you checked in on the BCTV archives since May 19th, you know, we began an exploration of folk art, which is an extremely broad and category of antiques, collectibles, fine arts, and one that's very near and dear to my heart, which I think it probably came across when we were discussing folk art. Last month we talked about folk art paintings, we talked about folk art sculptures, we talked about utilitarian folk art, and we talked about decorative folk art. So I thought this month I'd like to continue our exploration into folk art because it is such a broad subject matter. And I've picked four more subcategories. If you notice, last month's were two of them were true subcategories. Two of them were different definitions. One was about form. Two of them were about form. Two of them were about function. Well, this month we're going to have four subcategories that have to do with form. I hope you enjoy it. We're going to dive right in. I'm going to even skip my normal Southern style storytelling because we have lots and lots to cover tonight, and I have lots of photos that I have uploaded because in a lot of ways, photos are worth a thousand words. So what we're going to start out with is, let's go to the header slide if we can. That's folk art, the soul of the people. This is part two. And I am your producer and host, Bill Howes. I'm the owner and principal auctioneer of the Renaissance Auction Group and a personal property appraiser. We're going to start out reviewing the first four slides of last month for those who may not have seen that show, because those slides kind of set the tone and give you a little basic understanding about folk art. So if you will allow me a little leeway for about 2 or 3 or 4 minutes, we're going to stay focused on the first 4 or 5 slides that are a repeat from last month to give you a little concept about the basics of folk art, and then we're going to dive straight into our new 4 subcategories of folk art. So let's go to those slides if we can. Folk art. Folk art is a visual art emanating from folk culture as opposed to the fine art tradition. Once again, I'm just going to kind of run through these. If you want to get the greater elaboration, please take time to go to bctv.org. Click on the, I believe it's called Business and something, Business and Commerce maybe, and you can see the May episode. It's a diverse field with divergent branches, paradoxical inclusions, and debate over proper forms. What does paradoxical inclusions mean? It means sometimes you think, well, that doesn't seem like folk art to me, but it'll be included in folk art. And then sometimes you run into categories that seem like they should be folk art, and they are not generally included in the definition of folk art. So that's what paradoxical inclusions mean, and there's always a debate over the proper forms. What's folk art? What isn't folk art? What's folk art? What's contemporary reproduction folk art, etc. It is the artistic expression of, by, and for the people, and that's one of the reasons I love folk art so much. One of the great allures of folk art is its connection to diverse cultures. Absolutely, because if you enjoy folk art, if you study folk art, if you learn about it at any level, you will also be learning a lot about the various cultures from which that particular folk art form emanates. Folk art reflects the practices, beliefs, and activities of a cultural group. If you've ever listened to our show, you know that I constantly say that one of the things I enjoy about studying antiques and collectibles and being in the auction business and having the opportunity to handle so many different forms of antiques antiques, collectibles, fine arts, and decoratives is the fact that it then takes me into the tangential study of history, cultures, ethnicities, religion, social customs. That's really what I find to be the great secondary allure. Folk art materials are as varied as the world of natural and man-made materials, and that is true. You know, folk art encompasses so much that you get so many mediums that are used in folk art. Folk art represents the democratic expression of artistic sense throughout a populace. Another reason that I love it so much, you know, because I have a lifelong, or certainly an adult lifelong belief that there's artistic in sense inside of all of us. And that's another thing I like about folk art, because folk art proves that point in spades. Folk art, it can be decorative or utilitarian. Folk art needs to be handmade to be truly folk art. If it's machine made, if it's mass produced, then it may be, once again, faux folk art. It may be a reproduction of folk art. It may be in the folk art style, but it's hard to conceive of how it's true folk art. Folk art can be a folk art item can be used for its customary uses. You can use a stoneware crock as a stoneware crock, or it can simply be produced for sale. In other words, particularly in the 20th century, and as we have moved deeper and deeper into the 20th and 21st century, a lot of the folk art we see now is produced more for sale than it was for its very utilitarian purposes in earlier times. It's learned through traditional process and acquired in formal or informal settings or self-taught. And this is kind of important. In other words, one of the things that defines and that differentiates folk art from fine art, it is not a highly defined curriculum and a highly defined process in which you acquire the skills for folk art. Many folk artists are self-taught, and many of them have acquired their skills through traditions being passed down from others. It exhibits a broad range of skill and execution, and that's very true. But whether it's highly skilled execution or whether it's very rudimentary execution, there is still an allure to folk art and those items at both ends of the spectrum and everything in between. And it inspires debates over boundaries. We kind of covered that. What are some of the inspirations for folk art? They are as broad as the human experience, but some of the primary ones are religion, social customs, cultural lore, allegories, myths, signature cultural symbols. What does that mean, Bill? Well, how about the eagle for the United States? That's a signature cultural symbol, is it not? Nature, the events of everyday life. Chronicling the events of everyday life. Social context and movements often the inspirations and often spur the creation of folk art items. Music, sexual interaction, and love. That kind of sounds like life, doesn't it? Okay, now we're going to get to our first subcategory, and it's known as trench art. What is trench art? I've got one or two more slides, and then I'm going to show you some examples. These trench art basically are items relating to armed conflicts. Trench art was made forever. Soldiers were always using that tremendous amount of time that they had in between the actual fighting to relieve their boredom by creating items. But the trench art that we talk about today, the vast majority of it that we see and know about and respond to were created between the, you know, say 1860s all the way up to today's conflicts, but particularly, say, into the 1970s through the Vietnam War. It's produced by those involved directly or peripherally with an armed conflict. We'll go into that in just a minute. And it's often made from war materiel. Now, I'm going to show you examples of things that are made from war materiel and are not made from war materiel, but the vast majority of trench art that you see and that you see referred to in today's market, that is made from war materiel. The most common being the various artillery, brass artillery shells and artillery shells and metal armaments of various kinds. So I've got a couple more slides. Let's run back to them again if we can. Folk art, trench art, soldiers and who created it. There are some very significant, kind of slightly different categories, and we're going to see that as we get to our slides. Soldiers and military personnel obviously created it because they were right there. Those soldiers who had been wounding and were convalescing often had even more time on their hands, and some of the trench art that was produced as therapy. Then think about it. POWs and internees, they had the most time on their hands probably, and they produced trench art. Civilians, those who were the ancillary casualties and the ancillary those involved in an indirect way, but in a very meaningful way to their lives, they produced trench art. And then because a lot of it was made from war materiel, you had the post-conflict production of trench art where soldiers took this raw material home, these armaments and these shell casings and things. And then, interestingly enough, they had a more skilled craftspeople, people who were actually skilled in metal craft, produce items for them as remembrances of their war experience. So let's talk a little bit and look at some of these examples. This is an example of Civil War trench art. It is made from a cannonball, in which is inscribed on it, Gettysburg, and it is made from grape shot and mini balls. So this is, and then they've taken some rocks, which no doubt they got from Gettysburg, and the eagle has been formed. I don't know what the eagle is formed for, but this is some of the earliest examples. Now, once again, trench art was made forever. It was made as long as there's been wars, probably. But as you see trench art collecting going on in the United States now, and I'm going to clarify that as well, you know, probably the Civil War is about the earliest that you encounter trench art. Now, I will say that if you dig deep, and it's usually not referred to as trench art, but you will find examples from the Revolutionary War, from the War of 1812, from the Mexican War. But in the category, usually the Civil War is kind of some of the earliest examples. Here is an example from the Franco-Prussian War. Now, this is not American trench art, obviously, but, you know, a lot of what we're going to look at is from World War I and World War II. From the Franco-Prussian War, here we have a cannonball, and you have had three mini balls or grape shot. Is what those are. You have three grape shot balls applied to it to form a little container there, a little footed container. That's from the Franco-Prussian War in the 1870s. I put this one in is because this is the most common items you're going to find. I'm going to show you some very unique, some very special trench art items, ones that you are not likely to go find on a table at a flea market. But you might well find some of these, and you might well find some of these on eBay. These are the most common forms. Here you have an ashtray, and probably in the middle there, we can't see for sure, that's a lighter, where you pull the top off, and there's a lighter and flint have been inserted, a striker and flint have been inserted in them. This is the most common form of trench art. Like I said, usually ashtrays, small dresser boxes, either lidded or open, made from large caliber armament, you know, not from cannon shells and not from howitzer shells, but from large caliber personal weapons. So that's why I put that one in. Now I want to show you some things that Mr. Rockefeller ain't never seen. Here is a piece of trench art. By the way, the term trench art, trench art probably reached its peak in World War I, which, of course, the battles fought there were often wars of attrition. They were fought with troops dug in on both sides and barbed wire in between. They were fought, that was with chemical weapons like mustard gas. So there was a lot of time in the trenches, and that's really where the name trench art came from, even though it had been created before and it was created after. But this is a absolutely superb tea set made from the brass casings of large armaments and some small armaments too. It's Canadian. It's from World War I. And what I really think is pretty neat about this, one of the neatest factors, this is just past the Edwardian period. This is in the first decade of when George V was the king of England. But it's very Edwardian in style. The Edwardian period is considered 1900 to 1910. That was when Edward reigned as king. But that style, that very straight line style that's associated with Edwardian is reflected there in this trench art tea set made in around 1916 to 1917. I think the coolest little detail is if you look at the handles on both the covered sugar and the waste dish. The covered sugar is on the far right. The waste dish is on the far left. You can see that they made that little detail with bullet casings turned upside down. And so that's a fantastic, fantastic piece of trench art, far beyond what you're normally going to see in the general market. Here's an example of French World War I trench art. A lot of trench art was done with embossing and engraving of the shells. But here they went a little farther, you know. They obviously applied some heat, they pinched the base, and then they went in with their embossing and their hammering and came up with a really nice pair of vases that are made from large armament brass casings. And how about this? French World War I. This is what is normally referred to as a garniture set. A garniture is when you have either a central clock with two candelabra-like items on either side, or you can have a vase. Those are referred to as garniture sets. In this case, it is a clock. A very elaborate clock and two tall vases. These were made to sit on the mantle, and usually the clock sat in the middle. The two vases sat on either end. Sometimes they were pushed in closer together, but it doesn't really not. If you stop to think, that was made out of shell casings. And look at the elaborate nature of them. Not surprisingly, some of the finest garniture sets were made from French Sèvres porcelain, and so this shows those influences. But can you imagine? Can you imagine somebody, once again, this is folk art, folks. Occasionally you'll find example, and you know, we can't always say unless there's attribution. There was attribution on the Canadian tea set. There was not attribution on the ashtray lighters, and there was not an attribution on this. But this could have been post-war production where they took the raw material back and had a very skilled metalsmith, someone skilled in metallurgy, make this. But whoever made it applied some great skill and some great imagination to the use of the raw material. I love this one. This is British, World War I. They have formed an officer's cap with an officer's badge. The badge, of course, is the actual cap badge, but the rest of it was formed from brass and copper armament casings. Did you ever think? I don't know. I mean, that's pretty cool. You can see on the top there, you can see this one is from 1916, but you can see the bottom of the shell there on the top of the cap. Okay, I told you a little bit about how some of the trench art was made by convalescents. And can think of the kind of the irony of someone who's been in battle, in this case, in the Argonne Forest and in the Battle of the Meuse, and they're done. And as therapy, when they're wounded, they're taught to embroider. And so here they embroidered a map of that region, some of the worst fighting of World War I. And as part of their convalescence, they embroidered this very elaborate piece with the map, with the dates that they served, with their rank stripes on it, and with the flags of the Allies. So there's an example of a non-war material being used in trench art. Here is another example. This is from the Vosges Mountains. The Vosges Mountains are in Alsace-Lorraine. Alsace-Lorraine was the historical borderline between France and Germany, and it changed hands several times in the course of about 75 years. The Germans took control of it in the Franco-Prussian War, and then the French got it back in the armistice after World War I. But this this really kind of difficult to see this, but as is often the case with trench art, you will find various inscriptions, perhaps the regiment, perhaps the name of the individual that made it, the years they served, the battles they were in. That's some of the fascinating things about trench art, quite frankly, is it oftentimes has a history and a provenance that's right on it, that's either engraved in it or carved into it, that tells you where that individual was. And we'll see an example of this in just a second. All right, here's Italian POW, World War II. Remember, we talked about POWs, we talked about convalescents, we talked about soldiers and military personnel who were involved in the conflict. And here's an example of an Italian POW creation, a canteen that was made from once again, armament casings, highly inscribed, highly engraved there, with various symbols that of the Italian monarchy and also of the Italian state. Okay, here's trench art, U.S. World War II. That's kind of cool, isn't it? Now, like all folk art and like all art, period, to me, the most fascinating thing about this little object here is that somewhere in their mind, and maybe they saw somebody else do it first, because oftentimes one person would create something and somebody else would say, well, I think I can do that, you know, and they use similar design. But look at the body of the airplane. It's made out of three larger caliber personal arms. Somebody in their mind had to realize that if you took three shell casings and then you ran the wings, that you would have those three shell casings placed in the right configuration would resemble a B-29 bomber. And that's what that is. And that's what that is made to depict, was a B-29. And that's what a great piece of art. And remember, this was being done by people. Many of them may have had great skills as craftspeople and tradespeople before the war, before they entered the war. But during the war, they needed some way, one, to while away those hours in between battles and in between preparation for battle and the aftermath of battle. But they also needed something to distract them. And oftentimes, they were sending these things home. And they were sending them home as mementos and as just to say to their loved ones, look, you know, war is hell. But there are times when we have time to do something else. Here's an example that I was talking about where you have the information. This is a French POW World War II carved box. This particular French POW was in a POW camp just outside and just south of Vienna, Austria. He was apparently in there from 1940 to 1944, spending 4 years in a POW camp. To me, the most outstanding part, it's neat workmanship, but it reads in French, "The Souvenir of Vienna, Austria, 1940 to 1944. Now, that's some pretty dry humor, isn't it? You're in a POW camp for 4 years, and you create a box that, with tongue-in-cheek, you call a souvenir of Vienna, Austria. Anytime we create art, any piece of art is a 3D emblem of the creator. And sometimes it's not 3D, sometimes it's 2D, you know. But here we have a three-dimensional work that is an expression of human creativity, of human thought, of humor, of pathos. And that's another one of the things that I love about what I do, and I love about the study of antiques and collectibles, fine arts and decoratives, and the study of history. And finally, we have for trench art, we have three examples of carved items that were produced by Japanese internees during World War II here in the United States. Not our history, as fine a country as we have, our history has more than a few blemishes. And the internment of Japanese Americans is not our finest hour, particularly many of them being second and third generation Japanese Americans who lost everything they had. It was one thing to say, well, you know, we have to make sure that you're loyal to the United States, so we're going to lock you up. It was another thing to take all of their possessions and all of their worldly goods, you know, and that was nothing more than that was nothing more than greed, quite frankly. But here, they would get scraps of wood from the internment camps, and they would find ways to express. Can you imagine what it felt like if you were a second and third generation American loyal to your country, to have your country lock you up for 3 or 4 or 5 years and take your property, your personal property, your real property, and dispose of it without compensating you? Well, that's kind of what we did. But that's some examples of trench art. I believe that's our last one. Yes, it is. A very unique and unusual form. I'm going to go back there for just a second. That's fine. You can come back to me. That would be great. A very unique and unusual form of folk art that carries within it so many implications. There's the history of war. Once again, there's the calamities of war. The injury, the death, the loss of property, the mental anguish that war takes on everybody in a theater of conflict. And it's expressed there. All of those things are expressed, including the joy of maybe surviving war. All of those are expressed in items that you find that are referred to as trench art. So for our next subcategory, we're going to go to tramp art. Now, tramp art. Tramp art was a popular form of folk art from the 1870s to the mid-20th century. There were some examples a little earlier. There are still examples later, but that was its height of popularity. It was generally made from repurposed boxes, crates, and natural materials, specifically often made from after the Civil War, when a tax was placed on tobacco. It was demanded that tobacco be sold in wooden boxes. These are the little cigar boxes that we talk about, you know, and that we see. Oftentimes, those cigar boxes were mahogany or perhaps cedar. They were woods that were a good working woods. So people would take these cigar boxes and other similar types of wooden boxes, and if they were making larger pieces, wooden crates like fruit crates, and occasionally they would mix in natural materials, and from them they would create these examples that you're going to see of tramp art. One of the first things that occurred to me when I got to thinking about tramp art again, it's been a while, I've always liked it, was the work of Lawrence Geringer. At Roadside America. Now, Lawrence Geringer was not a tramp artist, and he did not produce tramp art, but he used and repurposed all kinds of wood from all kinds of things, like fruit crates, like cigar boxes, even things that were not wood. One of the very few pieces that Dolores Heinzheim kept, they refer to as the Barney Google House, because inside the crafting of that model, he used an old board from the Barney Google game. So they call it the Barney Google House. And that was just one of the very few models that Dolores couldn't part with. When you were forming this tramp art, what you would do is you would, first of all, you had to find the boxes or the crates, and you had to take them apart. And basically, tramp art was done with a pocket knife for the most part. I'm sure some people may have used different types of whittling tools, but a pocket knife. And then it was assembled with glue and or nails. Tramp art, like so many forms of folk art, speaks to the universal desire to create. And this is what I talk about. Heather Adams and I took a little trip up to visit the Heinzheims on a project we're working on for Roadside America. We did that on Sunday, I believe. And she was talking with me, and she was talking to me about someone who had been associated with BCTV for many years, and said that that individual's purpose was the demystification of TV. Well, back when I was in my 20s and 30s, I had a simpler purpose. And, I'd never heard, had very few people use the word demystification. And mine was the demystification of art. It wasn't because I didn't want artists to be held in esteem. It wasn't because I didn't want people to recognize the unique talents it takes. It's because I believed that art existed in everyone. And I referred to it as the demystification of art. So to me, folk art particularly speaks to the universal desire to create, and tramp art specifically does it, because most tramp artists were untrained artists. They weren't tramps. They weren't transients, the vast majority of them. They were simply people with much like model builders, you know. Most popular forms were boxes and picture frames. Wooden cigar boxes, I mentioned, were the most common construction material. Similar commercial wooden boxes and crates were used for larger, less common examples. And as I will show you here, coming up in one specific example, the arts and crafts movement that began in the last part of the 19th century in England and moved to the United States in the very maybe last decade or decade and a half of the 19th century and into the first two decades of the 20th century, I think inspired some of the designs in tramp art in general, but also they inspired some of the use of the natural materials that were not as common as the cigar boxes. Okay, let's look at some examples. Here's a covered tramp art box with an applique on the front. Now, how is this made? Study this a little bit. You've got big screen TVs there at home. And if you look at it, let's take the lid, for example. What that lid is eight different pieces of a cigar box, most likely. So first they were disassembled. Then they were cut so that their dimensions formed this stair-stepping. And then you took some type of whittling instrument, generally a penknife, and you did what was known as chip carving or notch carving on the edges. And that's how what this very, very ornate-looking piece, if you stop to look at it and you can see it on your screen clearly, you will see it is made out of layered pieces of thin wood, most likely a cigar box in this case, where the edges of each piece have been notched and each piece is succeedingly smaller and they have been set on top of each other. And then you have the embellishment of the bracket foot and the arched skirt. And then you have the applique on the front that looks like it may have some little horn buttons in it or something of that nature. So that's not the most plainest tramp art box, but a fairly plain tramp art box, covered, lidded. Now let's look at the next tramp art box. Well, now we've gotten a little bit more elaborate. Notice also that we have the heart in the middle, and we have a K on the left side and an S on the other side. And also notice that in this particular case, there's a certain architectural element to this. In some ways, this almost resembles like a Japanese pagoda or some type of oriental shrine. So now you're seeing the encompassing of certain architectural features into the construction of this box. This is, a more elaborate, ornate example, but it's still made the same way. When you look at it, it's still made from these thin pieces of wood which have been notch and chipped carves either on their edges or on their faces to give this very ornate appearance. And that is a distinguishing element of tramp art. You can see tramp art from across the room because it always has this very distinctive chip and notch carving to it. Once again, let's take a minute to talk about the term tramp art. The term tramp art was coined by a writer in the Philadelphia Folklife magazine. I believe the year was 1959. It was then kind of maybe assumed, and in truth, tramp art probably hit its peak of popularity in the 1930s. Well, in the 1930s, of course, we had a very mobile population. And 1930s were probably the height of the hobo movement also. So there was kind of this misnomer that was applied to it that stuck. But most tramp art was not made by transients, tramps, hobos. It was made by common people who had an interest in constructing these type of creative pieces, many of whom may have been working people, people with a certain amount of mechanical skill. But it was a very common form, and it began much earlier than the tramp and the hobo movement. It began in the 1860s and 70s. All right, now let's go to one more box. Now we've stepped the game up a little bit. This one is a little different animal. You can still, once again, I told you you could see tramp art from across the room. Well, you can still see that notch carving, but here they've taken some different construction elements. One, you have this very nice horse finial, which is, fairly well executed. You have the fish applique, and then you have the diamond appliques and the star applique on the left, and the other diamond appliques, meaning that they have been applied. You know, and then you have the step back base. So you don't have this one really. You see the chip carving is a minor element of the overall design here, you know. So this is a very high end example of a tramp art box. Now, the second most common form of tramp art was in frames. And you can understand why. You can understand how these, remember, you're dealing, for the most part, when you're dealing with cigar boxes and things like that, you're dealing with rather small pieces of wood. You have to construct these larger items from smaller pieces of wood, and then you have to assemble them together in a way that comes up with the form that you're looking for. This is a rather elaborate tramp art frame. Tramp art frames are very, very popular. They usually bring very good money when they come onto the open market. And this is a nice example. This is a nice, somewhat elaborate, ornate example of a tramp art frame. And here's an even more elaborate example. Now you see here, you see that the chip or notch carving is the centerpiece of the embellishment. This is... Is it an eagle? Is it an owl? Who knows? It's a mirror. It's a tramp art mirror. You know, I should have actually put mirror there instead of frame. You can still see the old piece of silvered glass and the old mirror still in it. And this is a more ornate example and has a figural component to it. As opposed, we'll go back here for a second. And you see there's no figural component there. There's geometric components. But here you have a figural component. So there was actually some carving and shaping, some extra carving and shaping involved. Now we have the tramp art model. You don't see these as often. But once again, the central embellishment here, and the reason you know it's tramp art, is that notch carving. And once again, in seeing this, I was brought back to Lawrence Geringer's models. Now, once again, Lawrence Geringer, I never saw one example. He probably did, and I saw an early example that almost begins to qualify for tramp art. Because his life, having been born in, I believe it was 1898 or 1896, because his life spanned the most popular periods of tramp art, I wouldn't be surprised if he took some of his inspirations from tramp art. He did not do tramp art, and his models were entirely different. You notice this model has the basic form of a house, but it has no siding. It has no interior. That wouldn't have suited Lawrence Geringer. But I wouldn't be surprised if, knowing when he was born and when he grew up, if he didn't take some inspiration from tramp art and from tramp art models. We know for one thing that he definitely repurposed all kinds of crates to make his houses. And that, if nothing else, I would be fairly certain that he got that inspiration from tramp art. Now, this is a Victorian piece of tramp art, and this is the one I wanted to show you where it is a planter, and here's the incorporation of natural materials, the branches. This is where I think you really see the inspiration from the arts and crafts movement. It's tramp art because you can see both the base and the planter itself, the basic decorative embellishments are the chip carving. You can see some feathers. If your television is big enough, those things in the middle are two lines of feathers going out in opposite directions. But you can see that the pedestal has been made from natural limbs. Very, very neat piece. Very neat piece. Now, here's some over the top. This is a George V commemorative clock. George V reigned from 1910, when King Edward died, to, I believe it was 1936, January of 1936. He was the grandfather of the current Queen of England, Queen Elizabeth. This is just an over, this is Canadian. This was produced in Canada. You see a picture of George V. You see the flag of England and the Union Jack. You see the maple leaf, because once again, this is when the British Empire was pretty close to its height. So there's the maple leaf for the Commonwealth of Canada. There's the Tudor rose, which is the symbol of England. You can see elephants and lions, and I don't know if those are supposed to be wildebeest or buffaloes, because I can't quite tell. All of those symbols of various parts of the British Empire. It looks to me on that left, I'm not sure if that's supposed to be a koala or maybe even a kangaroo, which might be for the Commonwealth of Australia. But that's about as elaborate and accomplished a piece of tramp art as you're going to see. And it dates from the reign of George V, which was 1910 to 1936, if I'm not mistaken. All right, here's talk about where do you get to this thing? This is not a miniature piece of furniture. This is a sideboard. This is a tramp art sideboard. This is where they've gone big on you. Now, this is a full-size piece of furniture, and you notice once again that now the carving is taken on slightly different. You still, if you're, you can see at home, I think that the notch carving is the embellishment on all of the medallions and on the flowers down on the doors, the two lower doors, and on the various geometrical designs that you see on the three drawers and on the cornice, on the superstructure, the top part, and the shell carving. All of that has the chip carving to enhance it. But that's how far, you know, when you take human ingenuity and human craftsmanship and human creativity and human desire, and you apply it at a level of tenacity and craftsmanship, then you can take cigar boxes or maybe fruit crates, and you can build a sideboard out of it, and you can come up with a fantastic work of art. Now, this is a modern piece of furniture. It's by a gentleman named Dan Pohl, who is a Wisconsin artisan. I put this in here because he has incorporated elements of tramp art quite a bit, as you can see, you know, on the diamonds, on the buttons, on some of the turned pieces. But he has also incorporated other elements of folk art. And since we're talking about folk art as well as tramp art, I just wanted to put this one in here because I think it's an outstanding piece of contemporary folk art furniture. Now, I want to make a couple attributions here. Some of the photos depict pieces in the Clifford and Nancy Wallach collection are pieces that Mr. Wallach has included in his books. Both are recognized experts in the field. Mr. Wallach is the author of three books on the subject. You can learn more about the Wallach's endeavors in the field by visiting their website or Facebook page. It's www.trampart.com. And remember, there's a 1P, trampart.com. Recognized authorities and well-published in both periodicals. And then Mr. Wallach, Clifford A. Wallach, has written three books. One was Tramp Art, One Notch at a Time. That was published in 1998. Tramp Art, Another Notch, Folk Art from the Heart, 2009. And A Legacy in Tramp Art in 2012. It was interesting when I was looking at this title, Folk Art from the Heart. Well, you know, when I was making the title for my episode, I called it The Soul of the People. So apparently those of us who are interested in and have studied folk art, whether we studied the category in general or whether we are experts in a particular area like the Wallachs of tramp art, we recognize that folk art comes from the heart and comes from the soul. You can also, if you want to know more about the furniture that Dan Pohl produces, he has certain standard pieces he makes in his gallery, and he makes custom pieces. Once again, he is a contemporary artist from Wisconsin. You can visit www.danpohlfurniture.com. That's just his name, Dan Pohl, P-O-H-L, furniture.com. All right, let's go back to me for a second or two, if we could. You know, being an auctioneer, I hate to be out of the limelight for too long. So I hope that you can get a sense, as we've taken these two evenings to explore folk art, that the great well of inspiration that folk art represents is the instinct inside of all of us to use human creativity to produce items, to produce tangible, call them three-dimensional, call them two-dimensional, but to produce tangible items. And for me, this is part of what I have always enjoyed about antiques, collectibles, fine arts, decoratives. I grew up in it. My parents, as I've told you before, are educators, but they were big collectors. And so probably, just like people who grow up around horses and people who grow up around cars, I probably assimilated it by osmosis, by being surrounded by it. But what I discovered as I got older was, and I analyzed what it was that spoke to me about, because for me, it's very diverse. My profession then turned me on to lots of other things my parents never collected. But certain objects just kind of speak to me. They have an allure. I'm drawn to them. You know, and it could be a fine piece of porcelain. It could be a primitive piece of folk art, a folk art painting. But as I analyzed as an adult, what I came to the conclusion was, it's the human spirit and the creativity that speaks to me. It speaks to me in lots of different forms, you know, porcelain, pottery, wood, metal, what I call flat art, as I've told you before, one-dimensional art. It speaks to me in so many different ways, but it's the human spirit and the human creativity that's speaking to me. So let's go back to, we're going to get into our third subcategory for the night now, so we can flip back to that slide, and it's called outsider art. And folks, outsider art is so broad and such a big category that I knew I had to break it down and to make any sense, and as part of a one-hour show and as part of four different subcategories, I had to pick a specific area of outsider art. So tonight we're going to look at Southern United States outsider art in the form of paintings, okay? Paintings and depictions, you know, drawings, paintings, etc. Outsider art refers to items produced by self-taught individuals without knowledge of formal art training. That's pretty much accepted. That's the definition of outsider art. It covers a diverse range of categories. Well, isn't that true? Actually, what I did here was I took a slide from earlier that you might recognize, and I realized that all I had to do was change the outsider art part, and that slide was what is the heart of folk art. And that's why, in some ways, outsider art is the heart of folk art. If you ever took one category and wanted it to define folk art, if you could only have one, then outsider art would be a good one to choose. And that's why this slide, I thought, you know what? This slide is true. The slide that I used to describe folk art, except for changing the top, a bullet point there, outsider art refers to items produced by self-taught artists without knowledge of formal art training. The rest was true. It covers a diverse range of categories. It's one of the purest displays of the inherent aesthetic, artistic sense in the human spirit, and it offers some of the broadest opportunities to collectors. And I'm going to show you some examples here. By the way, I don't know if you might have noticed, but for $4, someone bought one of David Bowie's original works of art in a thrift shop in Canada. It's being offered at auction. I think it's now up to around $18,000 or $19,000 or $20,000. But anyway, and it was kind of an abstract piece. But as an artist, as a visual artist, David Bowie was an outsider. It was outsider art. Okay, outsider art encompasses numerous mediums. It's one of the most popular subcategories of folk art. Like most categories in the genre, the boundaries of outsider art are constantly being debated. But, you know, in some ways, it's fairly set. You know, what's outsider art versus naive art, et cetera? That's where the big discussion is. But for the most part, outsider art is art by individuals who lack formal training in art. And its increased popularity has offered opportunities to self-taught artists. And this is very true. And we're going to see some examples of that right now. Clementine Hunter. Clementine Hunter was a Louisiana native. She was born between 1886 and 87. She was a slave. She was a freed slave in 1886 and 87. She was a descendant of slaves. And that's why nobody's real sure whether she was born in 1886 or 1887. She died in 1988. And I think if there is someone that Clementine Hunter may resemble in the folk art pantheon, it's probably someone we looked at last week, and that was Grandma Moses. They both lived to be 100. The difference in Clementine Hunter is that she started her, Grandma Moses, remember, didn't take up painting in the folk art style until her 70s. But Clementine Hunter started painting rather early in her life, in her 30s or so. She had been a worker on Melrose Plantation. Once slavery was done away with, then it became sharecropping, right? And whereas it had some vast improvements over slavery, you weren't owned, and they couldn't sell your family, it also was a very restrictive, oppressive and coercive form of economic slavery. But she was a sharecropper, and she also had a lot of talents which allowed her to work outside of the fields. And it just so happens that one of the owners of Melrose Plantation, as it passed down, started an artist colony there at the plantation. So Clementine Hunter first began her painting using all the leftover paint by the artists that that came along. She was probably one of the first, one of the earliest, in a group of the earliest recognized Southern folk art painters, primitive painters. This one's called Cotton Picking and Fishermen, or something to that effect. She was known for her vibrant use of color, particularly as she got well enough known, which she did in her lifetime, that she could buy her own paints instead of using the leftover paints. And then as she continued to paint well into her lifetime, and she changed her style to accommodate a number of different things that happened. We're going to look at outsider art by Sister Gertrude Morgan. Sister Gertrude Morgan was from Alabama. She moved to New Orleans in 1939 and took up painting in 1956. One of the elements of outsider art, Southern outsider art, is the religious influence. She was known as Sister Gertrude Morgan. She had visions. God spoke to her. And oftentimes her paintings, besides reflecting this kind of one-dimensional, non-perspective, non-formal perspective style, was they often included not only biblical themes, but biblical quotations written into the actual art. There was at one point that she had a vision from God, and God told her that she was the bride of Jesus, and that was one of the handles that she went by. We have outsider art by Mary T. Smith. Mary T. Smith was born in 1904 in Mississippi. She did not begin painting until the 1970s, which means she was well into her 70s. And she was a very prolific artist. She had a stroke in 1985, and that stroke slowed her production down to 2 pieces of art a day. It eventually resulted in her giving up art, but she also was in one of the earlier pantheons. Howard Finster. Howard Finster was born in Alabama, but he was a Baptist preacher, and God also spoke to him. And Howard Finster created the Paradise Gardens, which was on his property, which was a folk art sculpture, a rather large installation of folk art with, I believe it's 24,000 pieces of folk art. But he also did paintings, most of which had allegorical and religious themes. Mose Tolliver. His paintings are signed to Mose T. Wow, we blew through this time. I don't know how we did that. Mose Tolliver was from Mississippi, I believe he was, and he became well known in his time as a folk artist for his depictions of animals. We have the Prophet Royal Robertson. The Prophet Royal Robertson was a diagnosed paranoid schizophrenic. He had visions. He believed that God would come in a spaceship, and they believed that he would travel in that spaceship with God. He lived all his life in Baldwin in St. Mary's Parish, Louisiana. And you'll have to just check it out, because I'm going to run short tonight. I've never run this short a time, and I don't know how I missed it by that much, but something happened. Outsider art, Oscar Gilchrist. Oscar Gilchrist was known as the Bone Man. He was from South Carolina, not far from the corridor, the Gullah Geechee corridor, and he was a practitioner of folk medicine, a conjured doctor, and a hoodoo specialist. Folks, we're going to run out of time right here. Let's come back to me if we can. I had one more category for you. Who knows? We may have to add a third night for folk art. But I want to thank you for tuning in. I hope that our exploration of last month and this month into folk art has given you a sense of the breadth of the category and its attraction, why people are so attracted to it, and why it covers so many different subcategories of art using different mediums and different materials. So you might have heard there's some exciting news. BCTV will be moving in August and joining a partnership with Alvernia College at the downtown Alvernia campus. We look forward to that. There's going to be some exciting new things. As always, I thank you for watching, but I also thank you for supporting BCTV. BCTV is the only multimedia platform that brings you programs about the places you love and the things you care about, by the people you know. That's Berks Community Television. We're Berks County's voice to the world. Thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you next month.
All That Stuff on BCTV is supported by the Renaissance Auction Group.